House at the 10 o'clock. Look at y'all. Woo! All of you looking pretty. Yeah. Looking like you're happy to be at church. Say amen if you're with me. Yeah, it has been, I'm going to tell you, I have been praying that God would give us sunshine on a Sunday. And obviously, I need some work because we ain't had any in a while. But I'll take what we got. He's blessed us. It didn't ice, so praise Jesus. So we'll take that. So glad that you all come out today. Had a great 8:30 service. We're actually going to jump in and finish up the Ten Commandments where we left off last week. And so I want to just real quick kind of dive into a refresher of what we talked about last week. If you weren't here and weren't able to catch up online, you can. After the service, you can go catch up online just either on our Facebook page. You can go to our app at the App Store or the Google Play Store. You can download that on your phone. Or you can just simply go to our website, rlclive.com. And you can follow up with sermons, and I think if you click into the archives, you can go back several years of sermons just to see if we get better with time or whatever you want to do there. But we do challenge you to do that. Last week, we kind of opened up Ten Commandments because in our reading as a church, we're going through the Bible in a year, and in our reading, we are, everybody's loving the New Testament, they're loving the Proverbs, loving the Psalms, but right now, we are in the midst of the law. In the Old Testament, we are finishing out Exodus, which there's some great stories in Exodus, some fantastic stories. Moses, man, how many of you love that dude? Like Moses is the Old Testament Peter, okay? If you know Peter in the New Testament, Peter is the disciple with the foot-shaped mouth, okay? Peter is always saying something that he shouldn't say, and Jesus calls him on it. Well, in the Old Testament, Moses... kind of is this guy. How many of you have ever acted out of frustration before? Say amen. Amen. Then you can relate to Moses. How many of you ever got angry at people for something that you couldn't control? Say amen. Amen. Moses. How many of you parted a Red Sea? Moses. I mean, you know, he's relatable to us, okay? But we're going to talk through some of what he dealt with. And as we get into this, man, I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful for the commandments of God. Amen. People go, well, I don't know about all those rules. I'm going to tell you, I need the rules. How many of you need the rules? Say amen. Amen. We do, because we would be a train wreck without them. We need the guidelines and the boundaries that the rules set for us so that we don't get outside that. A world without rules would be chaos. And so you say, well, we would love to try chaos for a while. No, you wouldn't. You really, really wouldn't, because chaos could look like a lot of things. You don't want it, I promise you. So I'm thankful for the rules that God has laid out. I'm thankful for the boundaries that he's laid out. I love this part. I was reading and studying Moses this week, and just something that cracked me up. There's a scripture in the Bible that says that Moses was the most humble man in all the earth. How many of you knew that verse was in scripture? Moses was the most humble man in all the earth. Do you know who wrote that in scripture? Moses. Isn't that awesome? I'm sitting here trying to think. I'm like, I'm going to write a blog. Vince Daniel is the greatest preacher to ever live. Sign. Vince Daniel. And see, just see how it goes. See, how did, you know, he must have been. God allowed it to go in scripture, but still, I'm like, God, couldn't you have like somebody else write that down for Moses so that this didn't come up later? But I love Moses. I love what we've seen. So now we're, like I said, we're halfway through. Last week we talked about the up and down commandments, the us to God commandments. No other gods before me, no graven images. We said to honor and to revere the name of God, that we ought to take care of this name because it's like we just sang, it's a powerful name, this name of Jesus. And we ought to not treat it flippantly. We ought to give it value because we understand that names have value. If I walked into your home and began to curse you in your home and curse your name in your home, you'd be bent. But when we do it to God, we're quick to say, well, it's just a word. It just really doesn't matter, yet it does matter to God. It's his name, and it means something. There's value in it. And so to honor and revere the name of God, to remember the Sabbath day and to keep it holy, to work, 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 and work, 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 and then rest. But to be serious about our rest. I pray this afternoon that you get a nap. It's dreary outside. It's cold. I pray you get a God-ordained puddle on the couch kind of nap. All right? That's what I'm praying. I mean from drool, not any other kind of puddle. So not that anyone's confused, but I hope you rest today. I hope you get rest. And if your day of rest is not today, and for a lot of us that serve here at Real Life Church, we start about 7 o'clock in the morning. Some start even earlier than that, getting around. But there are people here at 7 a.m. that will not leave until about 1:30 or 2 o'clock today. And this is not their day of rest. And so I pray that when they have their day, that they're able to just disconnect and just be able to focus on how good God has been to them. I pray the same for you. So we get those four commandments that are us to God. They're the worship commandments. Making sure we have God first, God first, God first, God first. Remember who he is, what he is, what he's done, and what he's going to do in your life. That's those first four commandments. Now we touched on the fifth commandment, which is the first commandment with promise, but it's also the first commandment that's horizontal, that's us to other human beings. Honor your father and your mother so that your days on this earth might be long. I've rephrased that to my kids. I simply say, honor your father and mother or I will kill you. Doesn't quite have the same ring to it, but it works for me, okay? It's a promise that God gives us that we'll be blessed and prospered in the place where God has placed us if we'll honor and respect and to give honor to our father and our mother. But today we jump into some, and I'm going to spend more time on some than I am on others. So don't get bent out of shape. If you want to talk through one, then we'll go ahead and talk through it. But I just want you to know and understand that we won't have time to get to just live in all six or all five of what's left. So here we go. First things first. Exodus chapter 20 is where we're going to be. So if you'll turn there and just kind of leave your hand there, that's where we're going to be most of the day. I'm going to jump to some other scripture that you can write down if you'd like. But you may not have time to flip because, like I said, I got a lot to cover today. Exodus chapter 20, verse 13, it says, you shall not murder. How many of you think that's a good one we ought to keep? It's a good one, right? We ought to keep that one. Now, this one, man, I could go 100 different ways on thou shalt not murder. I could begin talking about capital punishment and just see what kind of dumpster fire we could start with that one. Is it right? Is it wrong? Should we bring back the gallows? Should we bring back the guillotine? Should we just start frying everybody? Let's electric chair them. Let's go old school and push them out on a pyre and light it on fire with an arrow. Or is that unlawful treatment of a human? So I could hear both arguments. I've heard both arguments. I have an opinion. This isn't the place for that. I could go another direction. In our country over the last month, we've seen some pretty radical moves being made. State of New York moving in the direction they did with abortion laws. State of Virginia following suit and actually pushing the envelope just a little bit further. It's amazing what we see. Then here's how that works. This is what happens with sin. The sin will get us to a place where we will commit a sin, and then it's easier for us to commit the next sin in line. Right. It becomes easier. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Right. Now, we'll play this game just simply with that. Let's not talk about something like abortion, because some of you may have never walked through. And this is something that I always love to say. How many of you know this is true? And this was true for me. How many of you, if you miss one or two Sundays at church, it's always harder to come back the third Sunday? Because you're like, oh, snap, somebody's going to say something. They're going to say, so I'm just not coming back. And then by the time you get to the fourth or the fifth one, I'm going to find a new church. Because then I don't have to deal with it. And it's amazing how much easier it gets the further out you get. Sin's the same way. That you step into this sin and you go, well, if I didn't get that much pushback from this one, then I could probably go to this one. That's why, and we'll talk about adultery here in a minute, but that's why a hello in a Facebook conversation turns into a how are you doing in a conversation to a private message to a we need to meet, and then on and on and on it goes. We only walk through the door to go deeper into a place. And so sin will take you there. It will take you deeper than you want to go. There's an old song, an old saying that said, sin will take you farther than you ever wanted to go. Okay? And it'll cost you more than you ever wanted to pay. And so when we read through this, thou shalt not murder, I could rest on the abortion laws and I could stand firm on what the Bible teaches on abortion, because here at Real Life Church we're very clear on it. Or if we're not being clear, let me make it clear. We stand against abortion in any capacity. I believe the scripture teaches that it's sinful. And you say, well, I don't know if I agree with you, Pastor Vince. That's okay that you don't agree with me. I will discuss it with you. I'd love to sit down and discuss it with you. I'm not going to argue with you about it. I'm not going to post about it on Facebook. I'm not going to do those kind of things with it, because that's just not worth the time that gets put into those things. It doesn't accomplish anything. And so I would discuss it with you. But again, that's not the direction I want to go today with thou shalt not murder. I want to go where Jesus went with it. Jesus says this in the book of Matthew. Here's the principle I want you to get. Don't explode on others. Jesus said this. You're familiar with the command. Go ahead and throw that back up there, Jeff, if you would. You're familiar with the command to the ancients. Do not murder. I'm telling you that anyone who is so much as angry with a brother or sister is guilty of murder. I love how people come to me at times and they'll go, I don't like the rules of the Old Testament. There's so much more grace in the New Testament. Yet you read a scripture like this and Jesus is like, oh, hold up. Let me level this up some. Now you don't actually have to kill somebody. You just have to be angry with them, and it's the same. How many of us would probably want to argue that in our mind and go, well, it's not the same if I'm angry at them as if I actually killed them. Well, according to Christ in Matthew, it is. So now what? That's why I love Moses, because like Moses loses his stuff a couple times. Any of y'all guilty of losing your stuff? Just like gone, just losing. As I'm getting older, I lose it more often. I lose everything more often as I'm getting older, but figured I'd get some amens on that one. But I find my temper is different than it used to be. I used to be pretty even keel. I didn't get too riled up about anything, really. I would not sweat it. I would just kind of figure, hey, God's got it under control. He knows where I'm at, and he knows what he's doing, and he's smarter than I am. But now, as I've gotten older, I get frustrated quicker. A few weeks back, I was in a store, and as I was in this store, this person, there was a conflict that was kind of going on, and the manager was back there, and I can deal with a lot of things. I just have a real hard time dealing with rudeness. It's just a pet peeve of mine, and normally I'm really quiet about this, but as I was watching the situation kind of unfold in front of me behind the counter, it was a new person that was working, and then a manager that was there, and as they were walking through this, the person was kind of just complaining a little bit about it. And I don't mind complaining a little bit about it, but they kind of elevated the complaining. And they were directing it at this person about how they didn't do what was right and they were doing it all wrong and they needed to fix it. They needed to not mess it up again. And I was just kind of watching, and I stood at the counter, and I said very politely, I said, do you need to leave? I said about like that. I said, do you need to leave? Snapped their head at me and said, what do you mean? I said, do you need to go somewhere? Well, I got to go to the bank. I got to go to the bank and get this done, but I can't go until I get this situation fixed. And I said, now's probably a good time for you to go. I just stared intently, thinking, I hope they don't come to Real Life Church. Because I'm too far in now. Can't let this one go. It's back and forth still, and kind of laughed. The person kind of laughed at my comment. I think they kind of thought I was joking, and because I didn't elevate, my voice didn't get loud or anything like that. I'm not that type of personality. And so, but then the person said something, and the person looked at me and went, oh, I guess you just can't fix stupid. I said, but you can fix rude, and you need to go to the bank now. It's so funny because I don't work there. Like, I have no authority whatsoever. But I just couldn't help it. I'm just like, bleh, it's coming out of my mouth, and I'm going, you know, and I'm like, oh, yeah. And I know some of you are like, yes, that's right. You tell him, Pastor Vince. Just because we have a right doesn't mean it's the best thing. And I had to kind of pull back from that a little bit situation. It de-escalated, and I wasn't mad. I was just frustrated. I thought, you don't have to treat people like that. There's no cause for that. I look at Moses, and man, Moses loses his stuff a couple times. And he lost it with an Egyptian. He said he walked out into the desert, the Egyptians beating a Hebrew boy. That Moses looked to the left and to the right, and then he killed him and buried him in the sand. Loses his stuff. There's another time, Moses is up on the mount right here. He's getting the commandments from God, and God's like, Moses, they've built a golden calf. I'm going to wipe them all out. I'm tired of dealing with this stuff. And Moses, I love this, Moses is like, no, God, don't do that. Don't do that, God. Grace, mercy, God. Show him mercy, Lord. Just show him mercy. Why would you have brought him out of Egypt to burn him out here in the desert? Now that doesn't make any sense. And God says, okay, Moses, I heard your prayer. I will not destroy them all down now. So Moses starts walking down the mountain. And then when Moses sees the golden calf, guess what Moses does? Loses his stuff. Throws the tablet. God just hand wrote these tablets. And Moses chunks them. Like, that should have been the 11th commandment. Don't break these commandments. But he threw them down and busted them because he's mad. There's another moment where Moses, God tells Moses, he said, Moses, I want you to speak to the rock. And instead of speaking to the rock, Moses walks up to the rock in frustration with his staff and smacks the rock. Somebody's like, why would God tell Moses to speak to a rock? I believe it was a lesson on parenting teenagers. My teenage daughter loved that one in the first service. Moses has lost his mind, got angry. How many of you have done something silly out of anger? We will do some crazy stuff, won't we? I knew some people when I was younger that used to hit stuff. Somebody's like, oh yeah, I used to do that. Got arthritis in every knuckle now. And maybe I'm just rational when it comes to that kind of stuff. I'm just not that kind. I've seen people that come in and they're like, I'm like, what happened? I got mad and I hit something. What'd you hit? A tree. I'm like, you know, God creates trees, right? They're durable. Hurricanes, tornadoes, thunderstorms, hail, lightning. The tree still stands there. And you thought you are going to have an impact on this trip. I'm just mad. Get you every time. God says anger, it'll destroy you. It'll make you do some silly things. It'll make you do things you don't want to do. When you lose your mind in anger, you will, make sure you get this, you will make a bad decision. You will make a bad decision. You will say something that you didn't intend to say. As a parent, you will look at your child and say something like, I will tear your arm off! And you're not going to tear their arm off. But out of anger, you've thought it. I will knock your teeth out. Most of you probably haven't done that, nor should you. But you'll respond and you'll say something. How many of you in your relationships have said something to your spouse out of anger or frustration? And it's there now. You're still dealing with it. You're still paying for it. You're still hanging on to what was said. Anger. And let me just be straight with you. It's not because of your nationality. I'm Irish, so I have a short temper. No, you're not. I'm redheaded. So? So I'm redheaded, so I'm spicy. I got a short fuse. No. No, you just choose to be angry and you need to quit. You need to stop. Because the way Jesus classifies anger is at the same level as murder. So check yourself on your anger. Thou shalt not murder. New Testament, I say unto you, you've heard it told to those ancients when it said thou shalt not murder. But I say to you, if you have anger against your brother or sister, you are guilty of murder. You don't have to like that statement, but it's a biblical statement, so it's true. And you have to figure out a way to embrace that statement because it's true. Anger is a time when we step solely into our flesh and the Spirit is not leading us or guiding us. It's just, we're elevated, we get frustrated, we get mad, and we just can't control it. You will make a poor decision. You will make a bad decision in anger. Second thing, Exodus chapter 20, verse 14. You shall not commit adultery. Again, how many of you think we ought to keep this one? Think this is a good one. We ought to keep this one. Just so you know, I'm pretty sure we're going to keep all of them. But here's what a principle I want you to give. Don't give lust a home in your heart. Don't give it a home in your heart. You say, well, Vince, I'm tempted. I didn't say you weren't going to be tempted. That's going to happen. You're going to be tempted today. And it may not be flesh that you lust after. It may be the pride of life. It may be the lust of the eyes. It may be the lust of your flesh. I don't know, but you will lust after something today. You'll be tempted by something today. Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 5. He said, you have heard the commandment that says you must not commit adultery. But I say to you, here's Jesus stepping up the game again. Anyone who even looks at a woman with lust or man with lust already committed adultery in their heart. Amen. Billy Graham said it this way. He said, it's not the first look. It's not the noticing. If there's a woman that walks by, a beautiful woman or a good-looking man, and you notice them, that's one thing. It's the second look that will take you down a path that you ought not go. Somebody said, well, I don't struggle with a second look. I said, why not? They said, because I never stop looking after the first time. That's not what I meant. You are going to be tempted. It's going to happen. Whether it's girls, gold, glory, getting high. There's a lot of G's right there. But whatever it is, those temptations are going to show up. And you're going to be tempted. And you're going to have to make a decision what you do with it. You're going to have to make a decision. You're going to have to put the things in place. Accountability is great. I'm going to tell you right now, if you don't have somebody to be accountable to in regards to lust, men, let me talk to you real quick. Men, if you struggle with any kind of lustful temptations, whether it be pornography, whether it be mild, ladies, I'll speak the same thing to you. You may not have to see it for it to be pornography. You may be reading it and calling it okay. Both sides, men and women. But whatever it is, you better find somebody and get accountable with him. The moment you get accountable with somebody and are true with them and share your heart, the temptation will lessen. It won't go away, but it will lessen, and you will have somebody that you know is watching your back, that's got you, that's helping you. But if you don't and you carry on in it, and whatever the temptation is, whatever the lust is, if you continue in it, it'll kill you. It will destroy you and everything that's around you. How many marriages have been crucified on the altar of emotional adultery? Not just physical adultery, but emotional adultery, emotional affairs where, well, I just connected more with them and not my spouse. You didn't take the time. Didn't work through the process. It's amazing to me how often we'll fight for, some people I see it, they'll come in and they'll fight for a better tax rate than they do their marriage. Because they've already made a decision in their mind how sad it is. How sad it is, because it's not what God intended. It's not his plan. It's not what he laid out. You say, Vince, you don't understand my situation. I don't understand every situation. And there are things the scripture lays out for us, but I will tell you the temptation is the thing that drives the first wedge if we let it. If we let it. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Third thing, verse 15 of chapter 20. Like I said, I'm going to get through these pretty quick because I'm going to hang out in some spaces here in just a second. You shall not steal. How many of you have ever been stolen from before? Whew, yeah. How many of you have ever stolen before? You liars. And we're getting to that one. Okay? Some of you right now have a real-life church pin in your purse or pocket. We count. We know. I know where you sit, too. You know, if you show up late for work, you're stealing. You leave early, you're stealing. You know, if you're kicking it on Netflix while you're supposed to be working, you're stealing. What? Yeah, I know, it's weird because we don't think about it that like. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to prosper with honesty. I want God to prosper you more than anything in your life. I want God to prosper you, but I want you to do it honestly. Amen. I want you to prosper in a way that's true to God and that would please the Lord, not just because you could get away with it. There's a big difference between being successful and having integrity and being successful. And so many times we live in a culture that kind of throws over this. And the Bible mentions there's like 100 plus, almost 138 different ways you can steal somebody's ox, donkey, lamb, goat, wife, servant, house, lands. I mean, you can steal a lot of different things in a lot of different ways. But ultimately what this is us making sure that we deal with integrity with the people. We ought not be a people that take. God created us as his children to be a people that give, not take. He teaches that in John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave. He's a giving God. And because he gave, our sin is no more. Because he gave, we have hope for tomorrow. Because he gave, and those are the kind of people we ought to be. But we live in a culture that screams a couple things. First thing that it screams is, if it's not seen, it's not wrong. If you don't see me do this, then it's not bad that I did it. It just means I didn't get caught. In fact, I will say that most of the time we get convicted is only when we get caught. Amen. If we don't get caught, we don't think about it anymore. We don't sweat it. I mean, we probably knew when we did it we shouldn't have done it, but that wears off pretty quick, especially if we don't get caught. Like, when's the last time your kid ran into the house in tears going, "I'm so sorry"? You didn't know about this, but I totally did this, 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 and this. And I just thought you should know. But how many of them, when you go, "Hey, I know you did this, 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 and this," they go, "I'm sorry." The apology comes after they got caught. Because that, I was going to tell you, they weren't planning on apologizing otherwise. Because we're only convicted if we get caught. And when we steal, when we take, when we assume things that are not ours, and it's pain, it's traumatic when you get stolen. I don't know if you've ever had house broken into or your car broken into. You feel violated when these things happen. Like, how does this happen? Why would somebody do something like this? Like, I don't understand it. Well, they needed it more than I do. Well, they could have asked. You don't have to take it. Just ask me. I got shoes. I'll give you shoes. I'll buy you lunch. You don't have to take it. But it's a culture we live in. It's just easier because we don't feel bad about it. The Bible says that we'll get to a place where sin does not even cause us to blush. Like, it doesn't even embarrass us to sin anymore. And I believe we're getting really close as a people to being there. You shall not steal. The scripture also that's found, and let me give you this one in Colossians chapter 3, because back to the work issue, I think we really take advantage of people that have blessed us. If you have a job, you're blessed. Okay? More people need to say amen to that. If you have a job, you're blessed. If you have the ability to go to work and you have some place that's paying you to come and they're paying you a wage and you can argue whether it's fair or not fair, but you are working and getting paid for work. If we would adopt this kind of mindset, whatever you do, you work heartily as unto the Lord, or as for the Lord and not for man. How many of you show up on time if Jesus was in your boss's chair? I know what you're thinking. My boss is not Jesus, Vince. But let me ask you this. Do you think Jesus is surprised who your boss is? So don't act like he didn't know. That's why the scripture is there. Work heartily. Work diligently. Work with integrity. What that means is you work like you ought to work, whether anybody sees you do the work or not. You just do it. as unto the Lord, knowing that from the Lord you will receive an inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ. Well, it's not fair. No, God said he'll take care of fair. Jesus said he'll take care of fair. Colossians 3:23, I'll take care of you if you work as unto me. If you work your tail off like you ought to, because I'm there and I've called you and I want you to be a light in this community. I want you to be a light in that workplace. I want you to be the example there. Then I'll take care of the what's fair and not fair. And I'm going to tell you right now, God can bless you more than you can get there by yourself.
Right.
Don't take. Give. Give. Prosper with honesty. This is an issue that Israel had. We see it in the book of Malachi, chapter 3, verse 8. He says, this is God talking to the people of Israel. He says, will a man rob God? And they said, how are we robbing you? And he said, you're robbing me in your tithes and your offerings, your contributions. And you are cursed with a curse because you keep stealing from me, the whole nation of you. That's God coming down on them pretty strong right there. And he doesn't get it, because if you follow on this text in chapter 3, he kind of gets to this place where he goes, I would fill your crops. I would rebuke the devourer for you. I would do all of this for you, but you set on continuing to steal from me. And I don't understand it. I would open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing on you that you cannot contain, is how God says it. But you won't, because you're set on stealing. Because if I don't get caught, then I don't have to be convicted by it. Exodus chapter 20, verse 16. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. We've changed the phrasing of this one a little bit and said, thou shalt not lie. This is a big one. How many of you good liars say amen? Let's just see. Here's some ways that people lie. First one is this, a half-truth. How many of you know a half-truth is a lie? Say amen. Here's why it's a lie. Let's go ahead and put it up there. Intentionally omitting portions of the story to sway belief. I just think that part was important. Well, it's extremely important. Well, I just thought I needed to go to the hospital. Why? Because that's where all my friends were. Oh, so you didn't need to go to the hospital. That's just where all your friends were. Well, I needed to go because that's where they were all at. You didn't tell me that you were going because your friends were there. You told me you just had to go to the hospital. That's a fictitious story. If I'm just calling anybody out, just call it a prophecy from the Lord, and you need to repent. All right? But we'll omit certain things in order to sway the story in the way we want it to be. We'll just kind of make something sound the way we need it to sound. And in doing that, we're lying. We're lying. People do it in business deals all the time. Well, this is what they said. This is what they said. We have to be very careful about not being those people that are called Christians, that are called those that are children of Christ. And that be our MO. Not only half-truths, but the next one is this, exaggerations. Fishermen, we need to talk. I'm seeing this trend. Actually, somebody sent me a message right after the first service. I see this online a lot of times. Where, like, I didn't know this. But ladies, you know how, like, you have a good side and a bad side when you take pictures? Ladies, am I right or wrong? Okay, some of you right now, if you're going to take a selfie, if you take a selfie, some of you are like, I've never taken a selfie. Thank you. But for those of you that do take selfies, some of you will take 4 or 5 just to get the right one. Am I right? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. And somebody, you're like, hey, take a pic, take a pic. And somebody's like, okay. And you're like, no, come up. Can you raise the phone up a little? Hold it this way. Because you know what it needs to look like so that you can then apply whatever filter to make it look like you want to look. Am I right?
Right.
Men do the same exact thing with fish. My son and I went fishing a few months. It's been a couple years back. I hadn't seen it as prolifically then as I do now. But I caught a fish. And I haven't caught many fish in my life. When I went with Braden several years back, I caught my first fish in almost 30 years. Okay? I'm not a fisherman. I'm going to stand on the bank and look like an idiot man. Okay, that's what I do. I just stand there. Now, somebody in the church took me, had a blast. I went fishing, and I got to fly fish, and I love it. I love it so much, I haven't been able to go back. Okay? I do love it, though, but this is something I'm picking up. Braden said, "You want to take a picture of your fish?" And I'm like, "Why?" He said, "Because it's your fish." And I'm like, "It's not much of a fish." He's not, "But you caught the fish. You need to take the picture of the fish." I'm like, "Well, if you want to take a picture of the fish." So I hold the fish out like this. He's like, No. That's not how we take a fish picture. I'm like, "How do we take a fish picture?" He said, "You got to hold him on the front and the back. And then you got to push him towards the camera." I'm like, What do you mean? He said, you stretch your arms out, but you got to do it right in front of you. So it looks, so like your fist is this big. When I take a picture of it, like eats up the entire screen. And people are like, "Pastor Vince caught Moby Dick in the Big Creek Pond. What happened?" I'm like, "Okay, that's why we do it." I figured out how you can tell. You look at fish pictures online, and I know all of you got a friend or somebody that posts fish pictures. Look at the size of these people's thumbs. Because when they're holding that fish picture out there, their thumb will be that big. Like, I'm like, "Holy moly, that man has the biggest hands I've ever seen in my life." It's not. They just got them close to the camera so they look bigger. Exaggeration. Exaggeration. We're good at it, man. I love to tell big stories, and I'm dramatic when I do. I'm this way all the time. If you talk to me in Walmart, I'm gonna use my hands. I'm gonna spit on you. I exaggerate my actions, but I hope that I don't exaggerate the story because I want the truth to be the story. I want it to be true. How many of you know a one-upper? Oh, see, yeah, where you're like, "Hey, I caught a fish. That's amazing. I caught three." "Well, no, I know, but my fish was as big as your three." "Now, that can't be true. I needed a U-Haul to take my fish home." And you can always tell, because it doesn't matter what you say. They always got something better. And it could be ridiculous. They'll even go to ridiculous exaggeration to make sure theirs is better than yours.
Right.
No. Like some people, like this is their home TV. Takes up a whole wall. "Well, I have a TV that is a wall." "Well, I have two." "No, you don't. Why do you got to do that?" "Because I have to have. Here's what exaggeration is this. Go ahead and put it back up on the screen if you would. Exaggeration is this. Exaggeration is telling a story, shading the truth in such a way in order to bring acceptance. Exaggeration comes from insecurity. It comes from a place of, "I need you to accept what I'm doing. I need my fish to be bigger so you'll think it's awesome." Let me tell you, some of you have caught some monsters, some freaks of nature fish.
Right.
They don't need you to make them bigger. They're impressive, just like they are. Here's what I think. I don't think God needs your story to be bigger. I think God needs to be bigger in your story.
Amen.
That's what I think needs to happen for us. When we start to think about exaggeration, the only thing that can be bigger, greater, stronger is God. And if that's not what's being made bigger, greater, stronger, then stop telling the story and make it about him. Because then you won't be exaggerating. Because he is great, the greatest. He is the name above every name. He is it. And it doesn't matter how big we try to tell the story, we will never encompass who he truly is. So be careful with exaggeration. Next thing is this, not only exaggeration, but we have denial. Denial is a bold-faced lie that refuses to accept blame. Some of you understand what I'm talking about with this. Some of you have been a part of this. Some of you are raising kids that do this to you. Some of you are you have worked with people that will do this to you. And you'll say things like this. "Did you do this?" "No." "Are you sure you didn't do this?" "No." "We have a written affidavit from 27 people that were in the room with video and photo evidence that you did this. Did you do this?" "No." "How?" "I don't know, but I didn't do it." Denial is just a bold, just an outright lie and the inability to accept blame. "I did it. I was wrong. I'm sorry." That's the extent that the conversation could happen. but rarely does it. Because if you deny it here, you have to keep denying it. And man, if there is anything that's hard to remember, how many of you know a lie is hard to remember? Because you got to keep telling the same story over and over and over and over and again. And if you made up a story, you know how hard it is to tell the same story again? It's hard. Can't do it. Not only denial, slander. Slander is when you intentionally shade another person's actions or words in an unfavorable light in order to demean them. You know, you can do this one without saying a word. People do it all the time. They'll say things like, you'll be like, hey, do you know so-and-so? And they go, mm-hmm. What do you know about him? Automatically cast a shade. I don't know about them. What don't you know? I don't want to say anything. How many of you know what I don't want to say anything means? It means I got a whole lot to say. And if you'll ask me one more question, I will vomit it all out on you. That's what that means. Slander, guys, let me just tell you something. The church. You know what the church is popular for in mainstream culture? Gossip. Women's hair salons and churches. That's who's known for gossip. How did we get that way? Because we do it well. We slander well. And we ought to be ashamed. Because that's not who God intended us to be. It is not who God intended us to be. Fifth thing, selective amnesia. We don't like to admit this one. Nobody does. But there are times that you have selectively forgotten certain things about your story. I don't remember. Are you sure you don't remember? You just don't want to remember. I don't remember. Let's go ahead and put that one back up there. Selective amnesia means forgetting the sequence of events that would incriminate you. We lie in so many different ways, and yet God just asks us, he just calls us to be truth tellers. He calls us to be truth tellers. Listen to the scripture in Proverbs. It says, the Lord detests lying lips, but he delights in men who are truthful. I used to struggle with this a lot, lying. I don't mind to tell you. And I wouldn't lie about big things. It was just like small things, but a lot of them. Like if Jennifer would call me and she'd go, where are you at? I'd be like, I'm about 5 minutes from the house. Knowing full well I was about 15 minutes from the house. Hey, did you eat anything today? Nope. Knowing full well I'd stopped and had a Mountain Dew and a candy bar on the way home. You're like, but Vince, that's just minor stuff. It's just a candy bar. It's just 10 minutes. What's the big deal? The big deal was that I told a lie and I didn't need to. And they come from a place of insecurity. They come from a place that's broken in you. It's sin. And for a long time, Jennifer on her desk had this little post-it note that she just stuck it to a picture frame. It curled up on the outside of it, but I will never, ever forget what it says. She doesn't have it anymore. I don't know that she lost it or she just realized we're good. I don't need the reminder. She doesn't need the reminder. Speaking truth just helps, and it just works. But the post-it note said this: the worst thing about being lied to is not being worth the truth. When you think about lying to someone, the moment you do, what you've said is, you mean so little to me in this moment that I don't even have to tell you what's real. Your value in my eyes is so small that you're not even worthy of me speaking what I know to be true. When we lie. The worst thing about being lied to is not being worth the truth. God called us to be truth tellers. And it's not always easy. It's not always pleasant, and I'm going to be perfectly honest with you, it's not always acceptable in the culture we live in to just be honest with somebody. Because we're afraid that we'll offend, or we're afraid that we'll make some people mad. I'll probably get emails because of what I said about abortion at the front end of the service, but I'm a truth teller because the Word of God calls me to be that. It calls me to be that. I don't get an option. Well, you're going to make somebody mad. Jesus said, know ye not that this message I bring will cause division. There are going to be people that do not enjoy this message of the gospel. They're going to fight against it, rail against it, cry out against it.
Right.
We're living there.
Right.
And yet it's there. The last one. You should not covet your neighbor's house, your neighbor's wife, his male or female servant, his ox, his donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Here's the last principle. Be content with what you have. We live in such a compare and compete society that we've almost lost this art of just being truly happy for someone else's success. Of just being happy that somebody else is doing well, even if it means they're doing better than you, and just being happy for them. Vince, I want to be happy for them, but I wish it was me. Well, I promise you, it won't ever be you with that kind of attitude. It won't be. If all you're going to do is spend your time being upset because somebody got there before you did or got it in spite of you getting it, then you're just going to end up miserable and lonely. Compare and compete. Well, because they have it, I'm not as valuable. I'm not as good. They must be better. No, that's an enemy. That's an enemy. That's a lie the enemy is spitting in your ear, telling you those things, that your value is based on the stuff you have. Your value is found on a cross outside the city of Jerusalem, where a man named Jesus hung there, bled, and died, and he didn't care how much stuff you had or how deep and dark your sin was. He went anyway. Stop sweating the small stuff. Stop. And Jesus knew, God knew it wouldn't be a small thing. He knew that we would struggle with this. Well, they just got a new car and I didn't. I'm driving this old piece of junk car. So, he's got a payment. You don't. We can sweat that stuff instead of just being happy. Man, I'm proud you got that car. I'm proud. Man, God's blessed you to the place you can do that. You watch what happens when you start being gracious and having gratitude and showing appreciation and being proud for. Watch what God will start doing in your life. You'll start seeing things happen in your life. But when we get content, when we don't get content, when we get stuck in comparing and competing. We always joke about tax time because it's coming. You can see it already at Walmart. No, I'm serious. You just walk by, and Walmart will start loading up on TVs. Because we got tax money. What are we doing? We're going to get the next biggest TV. Didn't you get one last year? Yeah. Does it work? Yeah, but it's a 55, and now they have a 75. Because that's what you need.
Right.
You need a sunburn when you stand in front of your TV. That's what you need. I love it. They'll be like, now they have one that's curved. I'm like, how many of you got a wall that's curved? That's just weird. Listen, I'm happy for you. Wherever you're at, whatever God's doing in your life, I'm happy for you. I pray that God blesses you beyond your wildest imagination. I pray that you would be a truth teller so that he's able to bless you beyond your wildest imagination. I pray that you would stay focused on who he is and live how he would have you, how he has you to live. Don't steal from God. Let him pour out the windows of heaven. Let him pour out a blessing on you that you cannot contain. But if we don't get these 10 right, you say, Vince, that's a lot of rules, 10 rules. You had to split it up two sermons. Let me give it to you like Jesus gave it to him. Love the Lord your God with all your body, mind, soul, and strength. Those are the first four commandments. No other gods, no graven image. Keep my name, keep my Sabbath. And love your neighbor as yourself. Honor your father and mother. Do not murder. Do not lie. Do not steal. Do not commit adultery. And do not covet. Jesus said, upon these two commandments hang all the law and all the prophets. he simplified the guardrails for us so that we had nowhere to walk. Now, you have to walk.